A simple glycoside is one that we very commonly encounter in our diet. That is that of sucrose. Sucrose is a disaccharide. It's of course known as table sugar. And the disaccharide sucrose is comprised of a molecule of glucose linked to a molecule of sucrose. And we can see that actually over here on the top of the sucrose, we see the molecule of glucose. And on the bottom, we see a molecule of fructose. Now, interestingly, these two sugars are linked through this oxygen right here. And that oxygen, of course, came from the hydroxyl of glucose, and it came from the hydroxyl of fructose. So joining these together resulted in the splitting out of water. And as a result, both of the hydroxyls actually got modified in the process. Now that turns out to create something I refer to occasionally as a diglycoside. It's kind of unusual. We don't see diglycosides forming commonly among sugars, but sucrose is one example of where they actually do form. More commonly, we see glycosides that arise as monoglycosides, as you can see in the other figures on the screen. So linking, in this case, carbon number one, which is on the sugar on the left, to the hydroxyl group of carbon number four, which is not an anomeric hydroxyl, creates a glycosidic bond for this structure here. And similarly over here, we see again the anomeric hydroxyl on carbon number one linked to the hydroxyl of carbon number four shown over here. These create the two molecules lactose, which I mentioned earlier as the first molecule, and maltose, which is a common disaccharide, as the second molecule. Polysaccharides commonly are linked together, each individual sugar units linked together by glycosidic bonds, and they very, very commonly use that 1-4 linkage that I mentioned before. Carbon number one referring to, in most cases, the anomeric carbon, certainly for any of the aldoses that we talked about. And most of the polysaccharides that we see are actually polymers of aldoses. If we look, for example, at the molecule known as alpha amylose is a polysaccharide that's found inside of plants. And it's a polymer of glucose where in which the individual glucose units are all joined by alpha-1-4 linkages. So for example, here if we look at this carbon up here, which is on carbon number one of the sugar that is right here, that carbon number one hydroxyl is linked to the hydroxyl of carbon number four of the next glucose, as we see here, forming a glycosidic bond. And that structure is repeated over and over and over and over, all the way through the polymer that we call amylose. Amylose is a plant polysaccharide, and it's very simple in that it only contains alpha-1-4 linkages. That alpha-1-4 linkage is also shown at the top of the figure, as you can see here, in a little bit more simple designation. Another common polymer found in plants that involves a polymer of glucose is something known as cellulose. And cellulose, as I said, is also a polymer of glucose, but has the distinction that instead of having alpha-1-4 linkages, cellulose actually has what are called beta-1-4. And so that designation is shown here. We can see this attempt to show the upwards configuration of what was the hydroxyl of that glucose, meaning it was in the beta configuration, linked to the oxygen of the carbon number four of the subsequent glucose shown here. Now that very subtle difference in structure between the beta-1-4 linkage in this case for cellulose and the alpha-1-4 case that we saw for amylose results in some very different things as far as we're concerned, okay? Us being, we being human beings. Human beings can't digest cellulose. We can't, we don't have any enzymes that will tackle that beta-1-4 glycosidic linkage between glucoses, as you see here. Whereas we do have enzymes that will attack the alpha-1-4 linkages found in amylose. As a consequence, we get energy from amylose. Amylose is a very common component, for example, of starch. But we don't get any energy from cellulose, cellulose being a structural component of plants, and so if we go out and eat grass, for example, we don't get any energy out of that. Whereas a ruminant animal like a cow, which has an enzyme in a bacterium in its rumen that can break down those beta-1,4 linkages, can in fact get energy from grass. That's why they eat a lot of grass, and use that energy for growth. Another common polysaccharide that we find in animals, such as ourselves, is that of glycogen. And glycogen is something that's a little bit different. Plants have a similar molecule called amylopectin that I'll mention in just a minute. But glycogen is a polymer of glucose that we use in our body to store energy in the form of a polymer of glucose. We store glycogen both in our liver and in our muscle cells. And this is very useful for us because we can use this, as I said, as a source of glucose, glucose being a source of energy. And that those glucose molecules can be released very readily from these polymers of glucose, as you see here. Well, glycogen is different than amylose. Amylose, you may remember, was the molecule that had the alpha-1 configuration of glucose, and it's a polymer. It had nothing more than alpha-1,4 bonds within it. Glycogen is different in that about every 10 to 15 residues, it has what we call a branch. And the branch means that instead of having an alpha-1,4 linkage, as we have shown down here, some of the glucoses also have an alpha-1,6. And so there's the carbon number 1, there's the oxygen from the hydroxyl, and there is the carbon number 6 right there. Well, this particular glucose here, you can see, therefore, has two different glucoses attached to it. One that is an alpha-1,6 going up here, and one that is an alpha-1,4 going across here. This 1,6 branch that we see here can then be extended further and further and further along, and the extension of this branch occurs not as 1,6s, but as 1,4s. So the 1,6 is only at the place of the branch, and then everything that gets attached out of here is 1,4 until another branch occurs, which will be a 1,6, and then it'll go off as 1,4s, et cetera. So glycogen has many branches. That's one of its characteristic chemical structures. And as I said, amylopectin is a plant polysaccharide of glucose that is similar to glycogen, but it differs a little bit in that it only has branches about every 30 to 50 glucoses. So it's not nearly as branched as we see glycogen being. So not all polymers of sugar molecules to make polysaccharides are simple polymers. Some of those polymers contain very modified sugars, and a really good example of that is something is this molecule that you see in front of it that's part of something we call heparin. So these molecules that I'm going to describe to you, the polymers themselves, are called glycosaminoglycans. And so glyco, referring to sugar, amino, referring to amine groups, and glycan, referring to the fact that it's a polymer. So let me show you on this molecule where some of these names come from. So if we look, for example, at the sugar on your right, we see that it has an amine attached to it. That is this NH right here, which is the nitrogen that gives name comes from the fact that this was a hydroxyl that was modified to make an amine group on it, and the amine itself was attached to a sulfate. So what that had the effect of doing was convert something that was a hydroxyl group on a sugar to something that was a sulfate that is very easy to ionize. We see that the sugar down over here was modified similarly, but instead of having an amine, it simply had a sulfate attached to it. But the result was the same. That is that the sugar had a molecule on it that could be very readily ionized. It could lose that proton that we see here, and the loss of that proton gives this thing a negative charge. So the carbohydrate portion of this, which is all that you can see here, is known as a glycosaminoglycan because it contains an amine group and some modifications to it. Now, glycosaminoglycans are commonly attached to proteins. And so if we take a glycose aminoglycan and we attach it to a protein, we make something called a proteoglycan. So heparin is a proteoglycan. It is a polymer that is attached to a protein. And this polymer is very interesting in the sense that because it is so negatively charged, it's actually involved in helping to prevent the clotting of blood. And that's a more complex consideration than I can give you here. But suffice it to say that heparin is very important in the body's healing process, and it's also important for helping to prevent the clotting of blood. So glycosaminoglycans are molecules that are polymers of modified sugars that contain amines. They're generally very negatively charged, so they're what we call polyanionic. When we take those glycose aminoglycans and link them to a protein, we make something called a proteoglycan. Now, that proteoglycan is different from something that we refer to as a glycoprotein. So the names here get a little bit confusing. A glycoprotein is something that is primarily a protein, but it contains usually a small modified oligosaccharide that's attached to it. So I've talked in class, for example, about examples where glycoproteins on the surface of cells are important for giving different blood types. So a slight change in which sugars are attached to a protein to make a glycoprotein give blood type A, whereas a slightly different modification gives blood type B, etc. The difference between a glycoprotein and a proteoglycan is that a glycoprotein will have a relatively small number of sugars attached to it, and generally they won't be very modified, whereas a proteoglycan will usually have a long polymer of negatively charged modified sugars attached to it.